Man, even if it's for the purpose of actively hating on it, I would not be caught dead listening to this trash. This isn't 2014 anymore, lady. Being as annoying as possible isn't going to make anyone want to look at you. They're going to want to look the other direction because nobody likes you. Painfully irritating all the way down. Worst hit of the year easily. Isn't it unbelievable that this isn't at the bottom spot? This is disgusting. Just look at the song title. Young Nudie sounds like a weak little baby with the way he mumbles, except his flows are all extremely clunky. The lyrics are horrendous. The hook is one of the worst things I've heard all year, and 21 Savage couldn't care less about the quality of his performance. This is garbage. So because I'm making this list, I have to listen to this song for the first time in quite a while. And God, is it still so hard to listen to. The production is absolutely atrocious. The vocals are processed so heavily they're barely even human. The singing is disgusting. The lyrics are criminally bland, etc. I could keep going on. But I don't want to spend too much time talking about this garbage, so next. This was the only song I had absolutely no memory of before making this ranking. And wow, this is bad. Morgan Wallen sounds terrible here, and him spelling out words one by one, or him spelling out words letter by letter for some of the corniest lyrics I have ever heard is no good at all. I'm glad I forgot this exists because this sucks. Oh girl, I like you. It's pretty interesting how this is so high because I still think this was the worst hit song of 2022. I guess this year just had some even worse stuff, but it also had better highs, so it's a more interesting ranking this time around. I got hoes in different area codes. This one isn't as bad as it is unfinished, so it kind of just sounds like nothing. I have no idea what people see in this that made it hit though. I don't want to talk about this one. When you're chasing what he's drinking, are you thinking about me? When you're riding where he's driving, are you missing my street? Terrible. It's just Morgan Wallen childishly talking smack about his ex's new partner, because he knows that she's just pretending to have moved on, now she's still constantly thinking about him. What a great mindset. This song has one of the strangest chart runs I've witnessed in real time. Listening to it is just a country trap song. I don't need to explain why it sounds terrible. Although I will mention that Morgan Wallen's ultra country accent makes this even worse. The weird thing is that this spent over a year on chart. Who was listening to this? Why? I still cannot believe this became a hit. It's just the stock reggaeton beat where two artists statically talk over them without any care, emotion, or anything to make them interesting. There's absolutely nothing of value here. It's nothing. What? But there's one that lives by the lamp on the nightstand. One that says don't cuss and don't fly. Please stop with the country trap songs. I know Morgan Wallen can make so much better than this. Alright, it's a quiet song. Rihanna is at the front of the stage. She is a fantastic singer. She sounds as great as ever, but this song is so boring, I am going to fall asleep.
Oh,
This is just a weak Jose impression. It has the same concepts, but it's way weaker, excruciatingly boring. The vocal production is kind of grating, and the vocals aren't powerful enough at all to begin with. This song did grow on me a bit just because I've heard it so much, but it's still not any good. The lyrics might have come straight out of a copy pasta. Everything sounds wacky and all over the place. And Kim Petras is also there for some reason, even though she doesn't really add anything. It's a huge disaster. At this point, I've heard it so much on the radio, I really don't care much for it at all. I need someone to be patient with me. Someone to get money when I take it from me. You know, I actually kind of like how Drake sings here. Wow, amazing, right? But my dignity is not allowing me to call this any good. You don't know what you did to me. You body lightweight. Isn't it amazing how this guy is still around in 2023? Anyway, I think I understand how this got so popular. That is definitely a memorable chorus, I cannot lie, but unfortunately, I was so appalled by it when I first heard it that I gave it a dishonorable mention award last year. It's a super clunky R&B track where Chris Brown doesn't sound great even in the verses, so we can move on. Living in the new world with an whole soul. I don't want to talk about this one. So I'm dancing with my eyes closed. Everywhere I look, I cannot hate this song because there's nothing here to hate, but there's also nothing that has any value whatsoever. The best way I can describe it is that it's neutrally bad. And I'm bad like the Barbie. I'm a doll, but I still wanna party. Pink felt like I'm ready to bend. I'm a 10, so I pull in a can. Like turning the Barbie song into a drill song was never a good idea in the first place. Everything that happens on this song was executed fine. It was simply doomed to fail from the start. I like the accordions. That's not something I can say often about popular music. The song is a bit lackluster though. 4 minutes is way too long for this. You've probably noticed that I don't bring theory into my music reviews, which is because I'm way too incompetent in that regard, but I do know what a perfect fourth is, and I can say that the perfect fourth throughout this entire song get annoying real fast. Other than that, it's just an average song for more than one. I can't believe I finally get to talk about this. This is always one of the worst cuts off of Starboy. The wonky synths already sound bad, but they somehow diminish the vocals of The Weeknd as well, which is, according to common sense, not good. Ariana is a better fit here than with Save Your Tears, but overall, it's shallow melancholy that displays none of The Weeknd's strengths. I apologize for giving this a dishonorable mention award. It's not that bad, but it's still pretty underwhelming. Wow, this song amounts to absolutely nothing. Traveling around the world, over the phone, driving tours. This song is pretty boring. Not sure how it's sticking around so long. I don't know if he's an angel, 'cause angels don't do what he did. This is a serious case of too little, too late. Because by the time the instrumentation somewhat builds up, I've already forgotten I'm listening to the song. But I am able to notice how Lainey Wilson, the feature artist, sounds way better than Hardy, because she's so much better at singing, especially here, that it's not even funny. Rocking around the Christmas tree at the Christmas party hop. Can we replace the song already? I've never been a huge fan of it, and I don't see why it has to be the second biggest Christmas song every single year. Paso Pluma doesn't sound the best here, and since the instrumental is pretty empty, that's really all I've got to say. I would be mostly neutral on this, but Kodak Black is such a bad rapper and his verse completely ruins the song. Drinking watermelon moonshine, cut the barn with a little light. Yeah, it's kind of just there. It's not that bad. It's not, yeah, just another song, I guess. Number 100 biggest song of the year. It just barely made the cut, and that's really all there is. So thank God I get to wake up by your side. Thank God. I would rather the Travis Scott song of the same name make it here instead, but Kane Brown, a country superstar, bringing along his wife for a hit ballad? Yeah, that's okay as well. I like the idea of that, but in the end, the actual song is pretty bland, so I can't hate it, but I won't return to it either. I really do appreciate what the song is going for. It's Miley expressing self-positivity, and in doing so, she indirectly inspires others in a friendly way. Unlike Lizzo, who's like, "Wow, you're special, you're amazing. Everybody loves you." This one is way better, but I still don't like it because it's pretty weak. The groove is way too slow. Miley doesn't sound the best here either, so it's really just weak. I have no idea how it got so massive. Maybe I'm just weird. I was really hoping the remix wouldn't be the one here on the year-end list because the original is so much better. So let's start there with the original. I really like the glittery production. Taylor Swift's pop hook is decent, and that's about it, because songwriting wise, this is pretty damn bad for Taylor. I don't like it. And then you throw an Ice Spice with her drill style and nope. 21. Can you do something for me? 21. Can you hit a little rich flex for me? Who wants to listen to a song called Rich Flex? I'm poor, I get it. But anyways, when I listen to this, all I can think about is how this would sound so much better if he had different rappers on it. Because it has so much substance, as the beat switches, as the cool melodic things too. But Drake cares so little about his verses and stuff that the song ended up wasted potential. I'll take you dancing in a country. Ignari C from The Placement, I don't actually hate this, even though that, it's just a huge red flag. Look at it, it's called Dancing in the Country, and it's by half of Florida Georgia Line, but still, I think it's a decently fun song, I guess. Oh no, I fall into the dark side. No. I can lick it, I can ride it while you slipping and sliding. I can do all them little tricks and keep the dick up inside it. It's just a gimmick song, forget about it. Is Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. This song is way too catchy for its own good, but the chorus is Jungkook reciting every day of the week he'll be in bed with his girl, which is every day. I don't want to listen to that. Jingle bell, jingle bell, jingle bell rock, jingle bell swing and used to hear the song everywhere on Roblox around Christmas. Those were good times. The framing of this song is a bit messy. The production goes damn hard, it's wild. But the subject of the song is about self-pity. It's like, why am I like this? Why am I such a bad person? Those are two opposite feelings, so I'm not really sure what to feel.
I'm on a stage right now, singing your favorite song, looking to cry, you know it.
Pure honesty. The opening actually almost strikes a tear out of me. I'm almost crying because it's so beautiful. The delicacy of the pianos and high-pitched vocals are so heartwarming. So it's a shame that the rest of the song isn't that good. Tusi's vocals kind of suck. The melodies flow clunkily. The lyrics, they're pretty weak, you know? So yeah, not a very good song. But damn, that opening, so beautiful. You gotta check it out. I know why this blew up on TikTok. That's a good clip.
Bury me in Georgia. Let me rest in peace.
It's like I want to like this more than I do, but there's no reason why I would think that, because I want to like it more because it has a lot of unusual production choices for Kane Brown. So it's a standout for him, kind of, you know. He's trying to experiment, wants to sound different. So of course I want to go into that sounding good, but still, he doesn't really manage. It still sounds like just any other Kane Brown song. So I can't like it that much.
Cause girls is players too.
This should be the most annoying song on this list, but somehow I don't mind it. And also Coi Leray sounds surprisingly decent, so this track is also decent as a result. Even I don't believe it.
I done it all, feel like shot it low, laughing to the pain, but shit is not a joke.
The beat goes hard, but Lotto is way weaker than Cardi B on here. I also don't really like the chorus, so this is just okay. No one was more disappointed by Beyoncé's big return than me. You know, I just don't feel it. The dance grooves of that album, they just don't hit. I don't know why, but I don't like it that much. I will admit that the vibes and production of this song are awesome, but the hyper quirky vocals are just so annoying. They get on my nerves, and I have to end up pretty close to neutral with this, even though it should be like top 10.
Have a holly jolly Christmas, it's the best time of the year.
This one grew on me a bit, I think I like it now.
Bitch, I said what I said, I'd rather be famous instead. I let all that get.
Damn, I'm pretty sad about this one. I'm hearing on the radio, that first word of the chorus, that one sounded so cool. It's my favorite part of the song. But then I hear it in the non-censored version, the real OG version, and there's nothing cool about it. The word is completely gone. It's just Doja Cat saying the B word in a really flat tone. Not flat theory wise, as in bland, uninteresting, boring. So yeah, that's my favorite part of the song gone, and I wanted to place this pretty decently high. Not anymore, bottom half, hee 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 ha.
I know that last night we let the liquor talk, I can't remember everything.
You know, I still think Morgan Wallen is a talented artist. Like, not just anybody could make such a simple track like Last Night so memorable. The writing and production are still one-dimensional, but he pulls out that really catchy hook. It's everything I like about Morgan Wallen in that hook, because he has a great voice and he has a lot of flair to it too. So I'd say this works fine for what it is. It's mostly just a forgettable radio hit though, so it's not that good. Still, 16 weeks at number one, damn, that's impressive. I have never been wowed by a Jordan Davis song. It's just really mediocre country music, but I've never hated any of it either, so it mostly, pretty much all of it just falls on that middle line. Like this one, number 52, would you look at that? There's this one high note after the final chorus that sounds fantastic, and that's the biggest reason why I like this. It's not much else that important. Younger no one that back calling me splurge. Why me jump right off the curb? Bentley spread fly like a bird. Spin on the first and the third. This song is pretty mid. It's catchy, but Gunna simply does not have an interesting presence as a rapper. But sure, he's not really the main focus of this song, so it's fine. Alright, so at its core, The Vampire is a phenomenal pop song that truly tries to make a stance as being special. But every time I hear it, I just find more and more little nitpicks. Olivia Rodrigo isn't the strongest singer. There's way too much rising action for no climax. All of the attention is given to the weakest lyric of your song. I can always find something I don't like, so I cannot say this is bad, but I also no longer enjoy listening to this at all. Yeah, I'm not a big fan of the use of the word religiously on this one, but other than that, this song is completely fine. I really hope Bailey Zimmerman sticks around, because he's a good artist. I feel like I would like this more if I could understand the lyrics, but oh well. It's the stock reggaeton beat again, but the production is decent. There are some percussion changes, so it stays interesting, and I'm pretty fond of both singers, so this is fine. Call this song lucky because I put this in the worst tracks of the month when I first heard it, and still called it bad in my first draft of this video script, but with this final listen, it somehow clicked. The production is really intriguing, SZA sounds as great as ever, and the hook is solid, so I find this song interesting even though I'm not very interested in the genre it's from at all. So yeah, impressive. I would say it's just another bland love ballad, but the warmth of the instrumentation creates a really nice backdrop, and Steven Sanchez actually manages to come across as a really sweet guy, so this is way more effective than I want to admit, but I'm fine with it. This is another song that I've bizarrely never managed to find anything worth talking about. That's pretty weird, but I can say it's not my favorite song about the color orange on this list, so be prepared when you see the next one. I really don't have many feelings for this song. I know SZA's a wonderful singer, but her lane of contemporary R&B is way too uneventful for me. It's grown a bit on me because I've heard it so much on the radio, but it's still not my favorite from her. I still stand behind my opinion that Midnights is a good album, but this was not the right single choice. It's the most ambitious song on the project, sure, because the songwriting is incredible and gets better the more you're invested into Swiftie lore, but Jack Antonoff's production here is just not it. It don't sound good, so I can't call this as great as I want to. Alright, it was nice to see Pink Panther smash through, but my feelings for this song are still a little odd. Sure, it has Ice Spice's best verse to date, but Pink Panther's performance feels pretty insignificant and filler-like. She's still the highlight of the song, but she's made so much better, so in the end, it was fun to hear this on the radio when it came on, but the song is not much more than that. This song works for what it is. It's a simple, upbeat song, so I think it would sound way better at like a barbecue or a beach party or some kind of social event, but I'm just sitting here at home doing nothing interesting. I don't have a life, so I don't like this as much as I should. I remember SZA being annoyed that this was her mega hit when she has so much better material, and I agree. But I like the idea of this song though. The whole point of it is that SZA calling her handling of her relationship mature is ironic, and the eeriness of the production plays into the uneasiness. So yeah, it works for what it is, but I just, outside of the radio, have not been returning to this one much compared to other tracks on her recent album. I don't have much to say about this one, so I'll just compliment Taylor for no reason at all. The thing about Taylor is that she's experimented with many different styles and genres, and she more often than not nails the sound. As for this song, I have no idea what it's going for, and yet it still sounds effective at what it does. Isn't that pretty cool? It's just another bland love ballad, but the reason why I'm still intrigued by this isn't the warm production that nicely displays these feelings of affection. It's more that Luke Combs is so transparent as an artist that I'm inclined to believe anything he says, and his music is also really solid, so even if this should be forgettable, it's actually pretty good. This was always my favorite cut off of Her Loss, which isn't saying much because that album sucks. Still, I'm pretty surprised because the beat sounds extremely clunky, but seeing how it made the top 50 of the year end list, I guess I was right in saying this is still decent. Watch me. I already reviewed this one on the main channel, so I'm too lazy to review it again. What's left of you? How am I supposed to tell you? I don't wanna see you with me. I'm sorry to all the music fans out there, but I must admit that this is my favorite SZA hit of the year. I'm a much bigger fan of pop than R&B, and I think she is a wonderful singer, so the only time her voice truly shines for me is when it's over a beautiful acoustic guitar like her voice is here. And yeah, don't hate me. Next thing you know, got a yard full of your kids, and you take them to church, teach them to fish. This was pretty much created to pull on your heartstrings. It's a slice of life song about watching your kids grow up. So the song isn't that memorable, but listening to it, it's just so sweet. Really nice listen. Good song. I keep the windows down and the wind in her hair. Keep her heart hanging on round every turn. This is a song that was barely cut from my best mainstream songs of 2022 list because it feels a bit weak in some spots. I felt that the vocals and hook could be a bit stronger, but it's still making it high on this ranking because the guitar work is awesome, especially the solo, and the final bridge is amazing as well. I'm really disappointed that this couldn't make that list from last year, but at least I'm able to give it some props.
Candy in the cup, gotta get paid, king in the streets, young nigga mage, spraying on the crowd, take to the grave.
This was such a good intro to Heroes and Villains. Future sounds amazing, and Metro's production goes hard. For some reason though, the outro of this track has Chris Brown, who not only adds absolutely nothing to the song, but also sounds way worse than Future. Luckily, he doesn't completely ruin the song, so I still really like this. Isn't it kinda sad how Morgan Wallen gets 7 or 8 songs on this list? I'm not sure how many actually, I'm too lazy to count, but still. My favorite of all of those songs that made this list is a leftover single from last year, and it's clear why that is. His notoriously long 36 song album is full of filler and incomplete tracks, and his talent is just spread out so evenly that, well, you saw earlier in this ranking that most of them are pretty bad. But the idea of this song is to be a message on Mother's Day, confirming to his mother that everything is going fine and he's still proud to be her son. It feels genuine, and in turn, it's a good song. I just wish we could have gotten more like this from him this year.
All my life, they be trying to keep me down.
I didn't like this one at first because Lil Durk's performance isn't great, and the child choir caught me off guard, but J. Cole's verse gave me a reason to return to this, and overall, it's a pretty damn well put together song. The production works well in the context of the message, so yeah, I like this now.
Baby, calm down, yo, this your body, it puts in my heart for lockdown.
Obviously, I was pretty underwhelmed by this at first, but after hearing it so much on the radio, it's a pretty sweet romantic track. The Afrobeat and strings sound great, and both artists have soothing vocals that work together really well. It captures a sense of serenity that no one would expect to blow up, and it's a slow burn for sure, but I think the public made a good call making this big because it kinda deserves it. It's a really solid song, so it's no surprise that it grew on me. I like this a lot. You have no idea how nice it is to hear this song played at normal speed. Like, all I hear are those nightcore remixes that they use on TikTok, and it sounds terrible, but this is a good song. It's not Lady Gaga's best, but I really like this one. It's at normal speed. I don't really like R&B the most, and it's even more annoying how I rarely have anything to say about a project of that genre. Luckily though, only the latter is the case here. This is such a nice track, and there's nothing about it I want to mention, other than how it was already a hit back in 2011, 12 years ago, so it's pretty cool how it returned and became even bigger. This is another leftover from last year, and my feelings haven't changed. I love the build-ups, but the climaxes aren't as great as I want them to be. Still, it just, I can't help but love this, you know?
Think about those sunsets that blend in the jean jacket nights. Was tangled up.
When I first heard this, for some reason, I tried to pretend that I didn't like it. who knows why. So I did indeed put in the worst tracks of the month. I don't know what I was thinking. I regret that. This is really good.
La que anda bailando sola me gusta pa mí.
This was the biggest of the regional Mexican songs that broke onto the charts in 2023, and I think it's for a damn good reason. The guitars and farty synth sound surprisingly great, and the track is super catchy as a result. Even without a hook, there's something here that makes it way more memorable than all the rest of the genre that I've heard, so this is indeed a highlight of the year.
Can't say your name up in my songs, might not fuck with you tomorrow. Can't get my feelings hurt today, I won't give a fuck tomorrow.
This goes so hard, the beat is nice, Glorilla does what she needs to, but the MVP of this song is definitely Cardi B, because she's still as inappropriate as ever, but this is a case where she makes it work due to some pretty funny lines, so I'm a big fan of her verse. Alright, I admit it, I was high when I put this in the worst tracks of the month, because this is solid all the way down. The lyrics are really cute, I understand why TikTok was all over them. The groove is super potent and the synth vibes are great. With the K-pop scene being so ultra hyper, it's just awesome to see this being as down to earth as it is. It grew on me a ton, so I really love this now. As someone who liked Pink Tape way more than most, I'm really lenient towards Lil Uzi because I view them as a vibe artist, someone whose music just needs to hit. It doesn't need to be special, it doesn't need to do too much impressive, as long as it's banger. And I have that experience with this song as well. It's a banger because even though it doesn't lead anywhere, it's a banger. It gets you so hyped for no reason because it's a banger, you know? I like this. I completely understand why Post Malone's music isn't for everyone, but it's hard to say that about this song because from what I've seen, pretty much everybody likes this. It's a really well-rounded pop song, and most people agree. It's still not my favorite from him because I think the hook could be a bit stronger, but hearing this on the radio was still a blast. They were some good times, really.
Like it up, keep it a stack. Bitches move on cause they know I got bands. They be trying, I don't give a damn, and I'm still getting money.
Wow, an Ice Spice song, it must be bad. That's what I thought at first, and for good reason, it's Ice Spice, but thanking the remix with Nicki Minaj, and wow, she goes off on her verse. She is incredible. So yeah, I really like this song now. I honestly don't even want to talk about this song. It's As It Was by Harry Styles. Everybody already has their opinions on it because everybody has heard it hundreds of times. I still like it, so if you want a review from me that badly, go check out my Spotify ranking on the main channel. This is just another really good song from Bad Bunny. The atmosphere is so cool, and even though there's not really a hook, the verses are good enough that they make up for it. This is honestly just another country song. That's my true feelings, but there's another part to my true feelings, even though it's just another country song. It's a really powerful country song, and I have no idea why. You know, I didn't put this in my best mainstream songs of 2022 because it's just another country song, but listening back to it again now, it just hits hard, not sure why.
Like a runaway southbound train, like an Arizona desert rain.
This is a solid Luke Combs song. For me, that's all I need to hear because I really like this guy. His production is always stellar and the best in the mainstream country game. His singing is as passionate as usual, and this guy can somehow make the most uninteresting lyrical ideas hit hard. So yeah, I really like this. Who would have guessed? Not me. I mean, yeah, me. I would have guessed. It's Luke Combs. Yes, I still like this. I'm not gonna review it because it makes the year-end list every year. That would be tedious. So we all have our opinions on it already anyway.
I bite my tongue, it's a bad habit.
I named this my favorite number one song of 2022. So that's not very good because it was on my best mainstream songs of 2020. It barely cracked the top 40. The number ones last year were not good, but this year they're very good. We got a lot of good stuff up there, but still, I want to give this song credit where it's due. It's a sweet alternative R&B track, and Steve Lacy really sells it. So yeah, deserve to go number one. It's honestly a bit annoying how much I like this. That sounds weird, but let me explain. I truly believe that Billie Eilish has made way better than this because this song, the lyrics don't hit that hard. But still, it's Billie Eilish. Everything else is done masterfully. She has this really delicate singing voice that's as beautiful as ever, and the tender pianos put in the work to create a real tearjerker for many, and I understand why they would cry. So it's a great song. I don't cry because I just don't, but I have to call this great. There's no way around it. Post Malone is one of the nicest guys in the music industry, and his music nowadays seems to reflect that. But what's a discovery to me is that Noah Kahan can often match that energy. So their synergy on this song is expectedly great, and the song also ends up great as a result. That's not surprising to me either because it's simple, catchy, and strong lyrically, so hearing this on the radio was really nice. I feel like I should like this more than I do. That's why I gave it best of the month when was that? Back in December. But still, even if I don't like as much as I really should, there's no denying how impressive the overall sound of this is. It's an incredibly well-crafted song that sends you into Ray's world of distress and regret after a late night out. And 070 Shakes, is that how you say it? 070 Shake, I guess. Y'all, her first interlude works so well. When something this ambitious becomes a hit, I've just gotta have respect for it. This is my favorite Christmas song, and it finally made the year-end list for the first time. Let's go. I think we're all glad that a fan favorite off of 2019's Lover that went under the radar finally got its chance to shine, and it had a pretty decent run at number one as well. Wow. And still, there's no reason why I wouldn't call this great. Taylor pulls out her terrific songwriting and production team for this one, and the awesome hook was easy smash hit material all along. It was one of the saviors of pop radio this year. So glad it's here. Is you fucking crazy? Is you fucking crazy? Is you fucking crazy? Is you fucking crazy? Alright, this isn't another sickle mode, but this is still insanely hype. Drake here sounds better than he has in a long time, When he actually tries, he brings some serious menace. And then there's also a phenomenal transition into pure trap banger mode. These two have been ruining their reputations recently. Utopia wasn't that good, and Drake, well, you know what Drake's been doing recently. But this song is everything we love both of these guys for, and I have to thank both artists so much for this, right? Because this is awesome.
I don't wanna know.
Wasn't this song just destined to be incredible? Giving such a beautiful melody to The Weeknd is a recipe for success. And Metro Boomin also went all out with his production here. Listening to this whole thing feels like you're levitating, and the percussion switch-ups are just a cherry on top. They are so smooth. If there was one reason why listening to the radio this past year was a good idea, it would definitely be this. It's been nearly an entire year now since I first heard this, and I still cannot explain for the life of me why I like this so much. It truly is just the sweetest country ballad ever for no reason at all, and it has no right to be, but I love it, and it's just one of those songs that hit deep, I guess. And yeah, now it's number 4 on this list. That is pretty damn good, if you ask me.
Cold shoulder, closing time. You beg me to stay till the sun rose.
Really, if you know me, is there any surprise that I love this? Zach Bryan had two of my favorite songs from last year, and he's back again, but this time people have realized how good of an artist he is, and this song hit the number one spot. That's unbelievable to think about, but I'm so glad that happened. And this song absolutely deserves it, because this is stellar all the way down, from the vocals to the production, and of course to his incredibly powerful songwriting that'll never disappoint. Yeah, what can I say? It's Zach Bryan at his peak. Or not quite as his peak. You will see soon what I mean by that.
So I remember when we were driving in your car, speed fast, feel like I was drunk.
Once again, just like the last one, is there any surprise that I'm in love with this? I've always found Luke Combs to be the most genuine country star of the moment, and him attaching his terrific production to what many consider to be one of the best songs of all time. Yes, it's the best new hit song of the year, and I think this has everything a cover song needs to have. Absolutely fantastic stuff.
To you, I'm just a man. To me, you're all I am. Where the hell am I supposed to go?
All right, even if I will never get tired of this song, it does get tiring talking about it. In case you didn't know, I named this the best song of 2022, and I still stand by that. The reason why it's still here on this list is because it was a hit last year, but it became a hit again this year. It managed to last long enough. It got like 60 weeks on chart, I think. That's pretty impressive, but anyways, I'm not gonna place this lower just because it's a repeat. Why would I do that? That just makes the list inaccurate. But anyways, I might as well talk a tiny bit about it. Though the songwriting and world building is out of this world, and the barren emptiness of the instrumentation leaves Zach Bryan's heartbreaking sorrow on full display. It's a masterpiece of the song. I've known this for 2 years, and if you want more like it, extremely high quality stuff like this, you'll have to wait for my best songs of 2023 video coming out soon. Woo!